By the end of this video, you are going to be an expert at OSC. Today, I'm going to teach you what OSC is, how it works, and why you should use it for your next interactive project. And be sure to stick around to the end of the video to see some useful libraries that I use to implement OSC in various pieces of software. First and foremost, OSC is an acronym for Open Sound Control. It is a content format that was originally developed at the University of Berkeley. If you are from the world of programming, it is similar to JSON or XML. Its original purpose was to share performance data, which includes things like notes, sequences, gestures, and many other parameters between musical instruments. That's where the word sound comes from in Open Sound Control. Today, however, OSC has expanded way beyond just sound applications. OSC, at its most basic, is a peer-to-peer messaging protocol. One thing that sets it apart from others is that it is open-ended and dynamic. If you are from the world of live theater or music, you probably have come across DMX and MIDI before. These are great at what they are meant to do. However, you could not send both a number value and a string at the same time because those protocols have a fixed data size. This is why having an open-ended messaging protocol is so important. Let's take a look at how we would use OSC. The OSC message is made up of two main components. First, we have the address, and second, the data itself. The address is very similar to a URL that you would use to navigate to a web page on the internet. I think it is easier to explain by using an example. Say we wanted to play a cue inside QLab, which is a software for both projection and sound. We would start with a slash and then would type the word workspace, then a slash, followed by the workspace ID, one more slash, and then go. When we send this to QLab, it will play the selected cue. All applications that respond to OSC commands will have their own address structure and will provide documentation that outlines what the address should be for each respective functionality. OSC also has the ability to send a data payload. Sticking with our QLab example from before, what if we wanted to play a certain cue number? We would keep the address the exact same. However, we could add a space and then type what cue number we wanted to play. We are also able to keep adding as many pieces of data as we want. For example, in QLab, if we wanted to control the live average level for a cue, we could provide both the low value and the high value. Now that we have an idea of what we need to send, let's look at how we're going to send it. OSC is what is known as a transport independent protocol. This means that it does not actually matter how the message gets from point A to point B as long as it gets there. Heck, you could technically send it over the telegraph and it wouldn't violate the OSC specification. However, when we use OSC these days, we 99% of the time are going to be using an IP network. An IP network is basically what you have in your home. It's either Wi-Fi or plugging into an Ethernet port. Within IP networking, there are two main protocols that we use: TCP, which stands for Transmission Control Protocol, and UDP, which stands for User Datagram Protocol. The main difference between the two is TCP guarantees that your message will arrive intact, and UDP doesn't make any guarantees that it will even arrive. Most of the time, OSC is done over UDP on a local network, which is just fine. However, if you need to send OSC long distances or are on a congested network, use TCP. Sometimes the application you are using for OSC will only support one or the other, so make sure you check out the documentation first. Regardless of which protocol you use, we need to send our message to the correct place. Each device on a network has an IP address. We will need to find the IP address of the target device that we are wanting to send an OSC message to. The last piece of information we need is the port number. In computer networking, ports are like little doors that we can open to let our messages pass through. The device receiving OSC messages will either provide you with a default port number or have you choose one manually. Generally, you can use any number that you want. However, be sure to not use one of the few numbers that are designated for other common services. Now that we know conceptually what OSC is, let's take a look at some real-world examples. Starting with QLab, in the settings, we can see that we can use both TCP and UDP for OSC, and it provides us the IP address to the computer. Let's now use QLab to send a message to itself over OSC. This would work remotely across the network as well. I'm just going to be doing it locally. Under the network tab, I will enter the IP address we found earlier, as well as the port number. We can then create an OSC queue, enter the address, and any data parameters that we want. Let's open QLab's built-in workspace status window and look at the OSC logs. Once we click send, we can see our OSC message show up. Nice. Each application sends and receives OSC messages in a different way. For you coders out there, there's an NPM package titled OSC. It is a great, and it supports UDP, TCP, WebSockets, and even serial port. It can also be used on both the browser and in a Node.js environment. The way to send messages is based around a JSON object. For those of you who like a node-based environment, such as Touch Designer or Max, there are nodes that allow you to receive and send messages as well. If your application is catered towards creative technology, OSC is probably built in by default. This brings us to why you should use it for your next project. Since OSC is such a widely used protocol and is supported by many applications, it allows us to easily make a wide range of software tools talk to one another to create awesome projects. If you found this video useful, feel free to give it a thumbs up and consider subscribing to support the channel. Also, if you are interested in seeing a project I use OSC in, check out this video here. And I will see you next time.